Hi guys, my name is Vivek and in this video tutorial we are going to talk about range partitioning in Oracle. Guys, if you have not seen my previous videos on partitioning, I will highly recommend that you pause this video right now and go ahead and complete those first. Once you have completed those videos, you will be able to appreciate this video in a better manner. Guys, another small request to you, if you have not subscribed to my channel already, please go ahead and do it now, so that you get a notification as soon as I upload some new content. Now let's go ahead and discuss what we are going to learn in today's tutorial. The first thing that we are going to discuss, what is range partitioning? Then we are going to talk about an error which I have already mentioned in list partition as well, but I'm going to mention that again, and how we can actually resolve that in range partitioning using MaxValue. Then we are going to talk about when and why we should use range partitioning. Then we will build on that with a real world practical example where I will explain, if you want to fetch medium level of data on lot of reports based on dates, it's a good contender for range partitioning. Then we will understand the difference between range and interval partitioning. Interval partitioning is actually an extension to range partitioning. We will understand that with a scenario where I have rolling monthly data in my fact table and only the current month of data is insertable or updatable. All the previous months of data is read only. How exactly range or interval partitioning can actually help with that kind of data? So let's go ahead and get started. So I have my transaction demo table here, and this is the syntax of range partitioning. So this keyword partition by range is telling Oracle that I want to partition this particular table based on range. Transaction underscore date is my partitioning key, and these are the three partitions that I'm trying to create. My first partition P underscore 2015 will store values where the transaction date is in 2015 or before that. The transaction date lies in 2017, that particular data will be stored in P underscore 2017, and if the transaction date is in 2016, then that particular data will be stored in P underscore 2016. So as soon as I go ahead and create this partition table, what's going to happen? On the storage disk, Oracle is going to create three segments each for a particular partition. So all the data where the transaction date is in 2016, it will be stored in the middle one. All the data where the date is in 2017, that particular data will be stored on this partition or this segment. And data where the dates are in 2015 or before that, that will be stored here. Now I have a challenge here. Right now I'm in January 2018. And if I try to insert a row where the transaction date is in 2018, what exactly is going to happen? How Oracle will decide in which partition it should go ahead and insert that data? So Oracle will throw an error that it does not know which particular partition should contain that data. And this is the error that you're going to get, that the inserted partition key does not map to any partition. So right now, if you see in this particular transaction demo table, I'm trying to insert today's date, January 2018, and it could not figure out that in which partition it should go ahead and insert this row. So it gave me an error. Now, if you have worked on a big data warehouse, you will know that you actually have this kind of data where you have issues with your partition key, you have null values, or you have values that actually don't belong to a particular partition. So in that case, what exactly you can do is you can create a partition called max value where all the values that do not fall in the specified partition will go. So if I try to insert a row for the year 2018, it's going to get inserted in this particular P underscore max value partition. For 2019, 2020, 2099, all those rows will be inserted in this last partition. And if you see, the remaining syntax is exactly the same. It's just that in the end, we have added this particular partition. Now let's discuss when and why we should consider range partitioning. So the first requirement stays the same. Whatever partitioning technique you want to use, the first requirement is the same, that your database object size should be greater than 2 GB. So you should consider partitioning itself if your database size object is greater than 2 GB. When exactly you should consider range partitioning? If you plan to access medium level data on a frequent basis based on dates. Now in this video tutorial, I'm going to focus on the words date again and again, though I'm not saying that you cannot use range partitioning on number. You can go ahead and use it. If you have an employee table, you can partition your employee table based on your employee ID. You can create four partition part where the employee ID is less than 1 lakh, less than 10 lakh or whatever. You can go ahead and do that. But majority of the projects that I have worked on where I have created range partitions, all of them has been on dates, and that is why predominantly I'm going to focus on that. The second use case for range partitioning that I have is if I have rolling months of data in which the data corresponding to current month is insertable or updatable while the rest of the data is read only. And we will understand what exactly this means in a moment. So let's go ahead and understand range partitioning with our transaction demo table. As in this particular example, I have assumed that right now it's December 2017, and in my data warehouse, I have to generate almost 700 reports every morning, and majority of them are based on current year data. So I am generating reports where I am reporting for current month data, current day data, current week data, current quarter data, and current year data. So out of 700, 90% of my reports actually fall in this particular category where I am pulling reports on data that lie in my current year. So if it's 17 December 2017, this is how my report categorization look like. 200 of my reports are going to run on daily data. 200 of reports are going to run on weekly and quarterly data, and the remaining 200 reports gather data for the current year. While the remaining 10% of the reports actually go ahead and fetch data from 2015, 2016 or that kind of stuff. Now imagine if your transaction table is not partitioned. As I mentioned in my previous tutorial, if you are fetching more than 10 to 15% of your data in a report, then the Oracle usually decides to do full table scan instead of index scan, and that is going to be very expensive when you are going to do it on a table with billions of rows, and that too for 600 reports. Like, God bless you, it's going to take forever. So if we go ahead and partition that particular table using range partitioning, what's going to happen? As soon as it knows that we want to access the data for this particular year, it's not going to consider the other three partitions. The only partition that it's going to consider is where my dates lie in 2017. Now imagine, guys, 600 reports fetching data on huge table, but instead of that, now it's going to fetch data only from this particular partition. That means I've eliminated almost 70% of the data, and imagine the improvement in the performance of my reports just because of this partition pruning. It doesn't have to access all that data now. It's going to do a full partition scan only on this particular partition, which is only 30% of the data of the entire table. Now, if required, based on my use case, I can further sub-partition this particular table based on region, and that particular concept of sub-partitioning is called composite partitioning, and we will learn that in a later tutorial. If I further see scope, I can create global and local index as well. I can create a local index on this particular partition on the basis of dates, so that I can go ahead and actually access faster reports when it comes to daily data or weekly data or that kind of stuff. And I can create a global index on my region column, so that if I have certain amount of reports that actually are specific to a particular region, they also gain certain performance improvement from that. So let's just quickly recall what we have discussed. If we have a table that's bigger than 2 GB, and predominantly we want to access data corresponding to dates, and when I'm talking about data, I'm talking about a reasonable size of data, much more than 10 to 15%, in that case we should go ahead and consider range partitioning. We can further strategize if you want to further sub partition it, or if you want to create global or local index on this particular table if they are going to help improve the performance of my reports further. Just as I created partition on this particular table, those 700 reports that I run on daily basis, they actually gained like 70% improvement in performance, and that's a huge amount just by simply creating partitions on this table. In this video, I have mentioned interval partitioning couple of times. Let's go ahead and understand what is interval partitioning by this particular scenario. So every day I get new data in my summary table. I have a summary table where I maintain rolling data for 12 months. And what exactly I mean by rolling data? So right now when I entered December 2017, I don't care about the data from November 2016. I'm going to go ahead and delete that data. So I only care about the last 12 months of data. Now the catch here is that whenever I insert some new data or I update some data, it's going to get updated only for values corresponding to this particular month. So if right now I am in 17th December 2017, that means I cannot go ahead and insert a row with transaction date in November or October, or I cannot go ahead and update that data. All the transaction that I'm going to insert have to lie in December. Now, what exactly should be my partitioning strategy? Can I go ahead and create a range partition here? I think I can. But the challenge here is either I create a range partition tables with lot of empty partitions considering my future that, all right, I have created 36 additional partitions for the next three future. Or what I do is whenever I run my month end job, I alter this table and add a new partition in anticipation for data from the next month. This is what I have mentioned in my second statement. Oracle actually came up with a better solution. What is that? That solution is called interval partitioning, which is an extension of range partitioning. So here I have the same table transaction demo, which is partitioned on range. It has three partitions. But if you see in bold and italics, I have added an additional statement that I want to create monthly intervals on this particular table. What does that mean? That means as soon as I insert a new row where the transaction date is in April, it's going to automatically create a new partition for me for the month April. That particular partition will only hold data where the date lies in the month of April. If I insert another row for September, it's going to create another partition explicitly for September dates. It won't have dates from any other month. So it's going to create another partition on my behalf expecting the dates from the month September. So this saves me the additional overhead of creating partitions every month end. If I don't care about the previous data, I can still go ahead and set up a job where I will delete or drop the partitions that I don't care about. Let's quickly recap what we have discussed today. We discussed about range partitioning, when exactly we should create it, when we plan to access medium level of data on frequent basis where the access level is dates. I did mention that it's not mandatory to create range partitioning only on dates. You can still go ahead and create it on number. It's just that in the projects that I have worked upon, I used range partitioning when it came to dates. Then we talked about interval partitioning as an extension to range partitioning, where the Oracle automatically creates partition for you when it encounters a row that does not belong to any of the existing partitions. There is a lot more to come. We still have to discuss what is hash partitioning. We saw glimpses of composite partitioning today, but we are going to understand in further detail in what scenarios we can use composite partitioning. We will discuss local and global index in further details, and we will talk about the enhancement that Oracle has done in context to partitioning and local and global index in Oracle 12c. So thanks a lot guys for watching this particular video. If you have any question regarding this video, please do drop a comment and I will try to answer as soon as possible. Guys, just one last thing. If you have not subscribed to my channel already, please go ahead and do it now. I'm going to upload a lot of cool content real soon. Thanks a lot.